Anjali at the back of the room, and Younes. So we will be giving a tutorial on dynamic functional connectivity today, and we decided to entitle it Dynamic Functional Connectivity for Dummies, not to offend you, but because we thought we wanted to convey those concepts as intuitively and as clearly as possible without entering into too many complex mathematical details. So for the ones of you who would be interested in such details and would like to go further, I invite you to have a look at the review paper that we published recently about the same topic. And basically this presentation will follow the same lines as this paper. So for a brief outline of what is to follow, I will first try to guide you from a stationary view on functional connectivity to a more dynamic perspective. And then we will see that if stationary functional connectivity is at the bottom of this picture, of this long road over here, many of the tools from dynamic connectivity can be seen as a path called sliding window analysis, which requires many different building blocks that we will be exploring together. And unfortunately, it turns out to be a dead end, and if you want to go even further, you need more innovative approaches to overcome the difficulties. And so I will also be later on discussing temporal modeling and frame-wise approaches as such methods. And so to convince you that I haven't spent 40 minutes talking to you about totally irrelevant stuff, I will conclude trying to justify the origins and the relevance of dynamic connectivity and to show you that it really has a link with brain activity. So to get started, everything started around 20 years ago with a young PhD student by then called Bharat Biswal, who was involved in a finger-tapping experiment. So he could get, with traditional task-based paradigms, activation in the bilateral motor cortex. And then he had the idea to also consider the baseline moments of his paradigm. That is, the moments when he asked, he suggests not to do anything particular when they were in the fMRI scanner. He selected a seed region that you see encircled in orange here, and he tried to correlate the activity time courses of this seed with all the other voxels from the brain. What he noticed was several regions that are colored on the right-hand side here that showed significant positive correlation with the seed, which means that their time course of activity was synchronized with the one of the seed. And you can also see that those regions also denote the motor network. And so even at rest, not doing anything, there appeared to be a motor network fluctuating in our brain. Later on, other people carried additional analysis and wrote about many different such resting state networks. For example, involving auditory areas, visual areas, or larger level systems, such as the famous default mode network, whose regions typically go down in activity levels when you perform an externally oriented, attentionally demanding task. Or regions from the so-called task positive network that will increase in activity when you perform such a task. Not only do you find many such resting state networks that fluctuate at their own pace throughout time, but it was also understood that they actually interact together. And for example, I think the most emblematic such example is the anticorrelation between the default mode network, in red in this figure, and the task positive network, in blue. And so 10 years ago, we had this very good stationary understanding of the brain. And that's when Katie Cheng and Gary Glover came in and perform a time frequency analysis. In other words, try to understand interactions over time between different brain regions across several frequency ranges that you can read here on the y-axis. First, they were interested in looking at two hubs of the DMN, the posterior cingulate cortex and the medial prefrontal cortex, which traditionally were expected to be correlated all the time, and so to exhibit a phase lag of zero, which is the light blue depiction in the figure. And they observed that although this was indeed the case most of the time, there were also moments, orange or light green, when the phase difference was not zero, and when thus those different regions were not exactly correlated. In other words, they noted within network interactions reconfigurations over time. And then they performed the same between the PCC and a region from a task-positive network, the dorsolateral prefrontal cortex, which traditionally, as I said, should be anticorrelated, and so should exhibit a phase lag of pi. And you see that actually, in many instances, it's not the case. You see light green or you see orange in this figure, minus pi on 2 and pi on 2. And so again, cross-network interactions seem to reconfigure over time. And this actually kicked in the dynamic functional connectivity field that is summarized on the right-hand side. So if we consider every brain node in this figure as a brain region, the red strokes as correlation between two regions, and the blue strokes as anti-correlation between two regions, the stationary view says that throughout the 10 minutes of a resting state acquisition, everything is fixed and the relationships remain the same. But in fact, what dynamic connectivity states is that you may have a start situation, but if we focus, for example, on those nodes over here, after some time, they may become anti-correlated, having been correlated before. And if we focus on those nodes then, maybe one of the nodes become related to another series of nodes from the network. Maybe another node will become independent in its activity profile and will not fluctuate in synchrony with the others anymore. And so most dynamic functional connectivity tools attempt to understand those changes over time and to capture them. So what is the simplest possible way to do so? Actually, the simplest option could simply be to take a temporal subwindow that you can't see very well, but there is a light gray window over here. So you just span the first time points from your time course, and you compute correlation or covariance between the time courses only within this window. And then you shift this window a little bit by a time step. And you do this iteratively until the end of the scanning session. And so you gather, for those two specific regions, a connectivity time course, which describes over time the relationship between the two regions. If you do this for all possible pairs of regions, you can, at each moment in time, for each sliding window, have a functional connectivity matrix that describes all those functional relationships. And so if you do this throughout the whole time course, you end up with a set of such functional connectivity matrices that we term a dynamic functional connector. And actually, this very simple framework is in itself enough to perform a very insightful analysis. And as a very introductory example, I want to point at the work of Pussy and colleagues from a few years ago, where the authors focused on the connectivity between the posterior cingulate cortex and other regions from the so-called medial temporal lobe subsystem from the default mode network. What they did first is to perform stationary computations over the whole scanning session, and to observe that in the people who would tend to daydream more frequently, there would be a lower average stationary functional connectivity. The relationship goes down. And then they applied this sliding window framework. They extracted those matrices. And the only thing they did on top of this was to compute a standard deviation for the particular connectivity time course that they were interested in. And when they did this, they noticed that the daydreamers would also exhibit larger standard deviation, larger fluctuation in connectivity between those two sets of regions. So then, many DFC attempts actually try to improve this framework and refine it from an ontological point of view. And the first location when you can actually play is at the level of the window. So for instance, the first obvious question is about the parameters of this window. What is the length that you have to select? By how much do you have to shift it over time, every time? And in fact, you can intuitively understand that with a very short window, you will be very sensitive. You will be able to capture connectivity changes that are very fast-paced. But at the same time, because you have fewer data points for the estimates, maybe you will also have more noise. On the other hand, if you lose a longer window, you will reduce this noise, but you will not be as sensitive to the fast-paced changes, the fast-paced fluctuations. And so the goal is to find a trade-off, in a sense, between sensitivity and specificity. And if I can give you one general rule of thumb to choose your window length, I would recommend to keep it at least larger than the inverse of the minimal frequency of your pre-processed time courses. This way you are sure not to include too many artifactual noise sources. Then you can also realize that for a given window length, you are particularly sensitive to one particular frequency subrange. For example, if you have a very short window, you will be particularly sensitive to very fast fluctuations. And so, why not try to perform parallel computations using many different window lengths next to each other? This is actually what people term time frequency analysis. And so, in this example from Rapp, Gommer, and Liu, the authors were interested in the relationship between the right and the left motor cortices at rest, before on the right, and after on the left, the intake of caffeine. And below here, they plotted a time frequency depiction with frequencies on the y-axis and time running on the x-axis. So when you see a red color, It means that cross magnitude between the signal is very high. So for example, here, both signals exhibit very strong fluctuations and the region is colored in red. There are also a set of arrows that I hope you can see on the figures. They point rightwards if there is a phase difference of zero between the two time courses, so when they are correlated, still here, for example. And they actually point on the left, for example, here, when the two time courses are anti-correlated to each other. And so if you perform a time frequency analysis, you have much more information. And actually, cross magnitude and cross phase are two very different facets of connectivity. For example, in this particular study, when the authors tried correlating the cross magnitude of the cross phase time course with the connectivity time course, they showed that upon the intake of caffeine, cross magnitude would have a decreased correlation, but cross phase would have an increased correlation. Then a third possible strategy is to rather look at the shape of the window, which so far is rectangular in what I've described. This means that if you have a time point that just enters the window, it will immediately be given a very strong weight and have a very strong influence on the connectivity estimate. And so to try and avoid this, you may want to use tapered or smoothed windows in which a time point that just enters the computation is first given a very low weight and will only be given a larger weight after the time window has been shifted by a few steps. Finally, instead of choosing yourself parameters, you can also let the data decide for you in data-driven techniques, such as, for example, dynamic connectivity detection. So, not to go too much into details, just to give you a brief overview of this technique. The principle is that you are going to scan your whole resting state recording, and you are going to find the time point for which it is most likely that before and after you have different connectivity matrices representing your brain interactions. You are going to select this time point, T1, and then you are going to recursively, iteratively perform the same process over and over again, further splitting your time course until there is no more gain in likelihood in doing so. And so to benchmark this process, what the authors did were to consider a task-based setting in which subjects suffered a very stressful stimulus that is depicted at the bottom over here. So when you read the pink lines, subjects were instructed that they would have to give a presentation in front of an expert panel, so a very stressful stimulus. And between the dark blue lines, they were told that no, in the end, they wouldn't have to present what they prepared. And so what the authors noticed is that across subjects, there is quite consistent data-driven detection of connectivity changes, and that it spanned very often those two stimuli, or also other moments that were conserved across the different subjects. Finally, for another possibility for data-driven window definition, I want to touch upon dynamic conditional correlation. So in this technique, you start with an initial connectivity estimate from the beginning of your time course, and then you gradually add in new time points to refine this connectivity estimate. So here you have a simulated example for an oscillatory behavior of connectivity and a comparison between many sliding window settings and the DCC approach, which is in dark green. And I think the important figure is here, because here the authors compute mean square error, so how far away from reality are you with those different techniques. And they noticed that DCC, which is purely data-driven, has a mean square error as low as the best possible case that you could find for any possible standing window parameters. So the best possible standing window setting does not better than this data-driven technique. So now we've covered one way to enhance the standing window pipeline. And a second obvious possibility is to act at the level of the computation of correlation or of covariance. So then, for instance, you could try to use higher order, more elaborate criteria to assess connectivity between brain regions. And this is what Kiviniemi and colleagues first did in 2011. So what they did was first to compute a stationary standard independent component analysis on the full 10-minute scanning session, and to isolate the default mode network independent component, which is depicted over here. So it features most notably posterior cingulate cortex signal and medial prefrontal cortex signal, the two hubs from the DMN. Then they did the same in each of the sliding windows of the sliding window framework. And so for each sliding window, they could compute a separate default mode network independent component. And they looked at the spatial patterns and observed that sometimes, for example, in the first frame or in the last frame, there was the expression of the frontal networks, the frontal regions, whereas some other times, for example at frame 49, there is no more frontal signal. So it really seems that the spatial pattern of DMN activation is not conserved throughout time and changes. This is confirmed if you spatially correlate the classical independent component, stationarily computed, with those standing window estimates. And here you have a depiction of cumulative incidence across those standing window maps. And you can see that the regions that are on average most present are the two hubs from the DMN, but also that the regions that show most fluctuations across standing window in their degree of expression are also the two hubs from the DMN. Finally, another option at this level is to rather look at your connectivity matrices and state that, in fact, there will only be a restricted set of connections that will be non-null. In other words, you can cast sparsity on your set of functional connections to try and simplify your problem. And so with this, we have now covered the main ways to methodologically enhance the standing window pipeline. But of course, it's also possible to act at the level of the computed features, because this is very complex information. And in order to perform analysis, you would maybe like to summarize it a little bit. And a first way to do so would be the use of dynamic graph analysis. So most of you probably know that graph-based techniques are very versatile and can be applied to many different fields, including the field of functional connectivity. So if you have a set of functional connectivity matrices, a dynamic functional connectome, for each of those matrices, you can perform either a manual thresholding to remove the edges that are not correlated sufficiently strongly, or if you had sparsity embedded in your pipeline before, as I alluded to in the former slide, it will also work. You end up with a restricted set of non-null edges on which you can perform graph analysis and compute relevant network-level features informative of how information diffuses in the brain. For example, for a given node, you can look at how tightly interconnected the neighbors from this node are, which is the clustering coefficient. Otherwise, you can look at how long it takes to jump from one node of the network to another. And if this path is the shortest path is very limited in jumps, then so the efficiency is very high for the network. Remote information flow is eased. Actually, those two features were very useful in stationary analysis of the brain, because people could understand by this mean that the brain is actually a so-called small world network. In other words, if you have an information at a certain location in your network, it can be very easily transmitted locally because there is a high clustering coefficient. And it can also at the same time be easily transmitted at very remote locations thanks to a few edges linking remote parts of the network. So there is also at the same time a large efficiency in this setting. And so there are also a few other graph metrics, such as the degree value, which is proportional to the number of neighbors that a given node has, or modularity, which is larger if a particular set of nodes is strongly interconnected and at the same time not strongly connected to the other modules from the network. So the question at this stage is whether it makes sense to compute those metrics dynamically on each functional connectivity matrix from this dynamic functional connectome. And I think the answer is yes, because people performing such analysis in the past already, for example, for efficiency and for clustering coefficient, did notice strong fluctuations a long time. So there seem to be such large-scale rearrangements at the level of the brain. And then the next step is to try to understand what they mean. And this is the endeavor undertaken amongst other groups by Betzel and colleagues in a recent article, where the authors were interested in tracking dynamic connectivity fluctuations at rest and noticed the presence of two different moments in their data. So here the y-axis denotes the number of connections at a given time point that were exhibiting very strong dynamic fluctuations. And so you see there are some peaks in this graph, which are so-called excursion time points, moments when many different connections are very strong together. And there are also humps, moments that we call non-excursion time points, when few connections are very strong. If we try to understand this further, in the excursion time points, we actually have very strong connections between nodes that belong to the same module, which are indexed, each module is indexed by a different color in this figure. Whereas in the non-excursion time points, in general, connectivity weights are less strong and you have a less modular architecture. This was also confirmed when they explicitly computed modularity in this network. And so it seems that the brain shifts between moments when it's really segregated in separate functional modules, or when those modules are actually interacting more together. And this was actually confirmed separately by the group of Zaleski, who this time looked at efficiency, which I remind you is a measure of how easily information can flow globally in the network. They computed efficiency for many different brain regions over time in different subjects, and they noticed the presence of two types of moments. Moments when efficiency would generally be very low across the brain, and moments when efficiency would generally be much higher. And so again, it seems that at some time points, information can flow efficiently between remote locations of the brain, which are probably the moments when the brain is not modular. And then when the brain is modular, every network is segregated from the others, and so you really have independently active networks. Then this was further confirmed by Liégeois and colleagues, who were interested in understanding how this can fit to the structural template of the brain. So which of those two types of state is closer to the brain structure architecture? So here you have the correlation between functional connectivity matrices over time with the structural brain scaffold. And actually, they noticed that the peaks in this graph, the moments of larger correlation, which are red on the right in those two plots, were also the moments when efficiency was low and when modularity was high. So when those networks were really segregated from each other. And it's also confirmed over here. Here you see that there are way less strong connectivity weights between different modules. And so it seems that the default state of the brain that is constrained by the structure is this state in which the networks are separated. And there are excursions in states when those networks interact, but this is not the norm. And actually, this is only captured by dynamic tools. You can't capture this with stationary analysis. So then you will ask me if it makes sense to study this, if it brings anything to understand cognition. And it actually does. For example, as shown by Chen et al. In a recent paper, where they were looking at how easily different brain nodes could reconfigure their modular allegiance, or in other words, could dissociate from their normal module to go and interact with other modules. They noticed that there was a restricted set of nodes in two separate analyses that were particularly flexible, and that most of those nodes were actually the red nodes belonging to the salience network. And then they wondered how this would change across individuals. And they noticed that the individuals who would have salience nodes exhibiting the largest flexibility would also be the individuals that would have the greater cognitive flexibility. So there is really an interest in applying this dynamic analysis. Finally, there is another way to summarize connectivity features, which is rather to try and extract a restricted set of dynamic function connectivity states. So to do this, we start again from a set of functional connectivity matrices over time, and what we do first is to concatenate the data across different subjects. So for each of those matrices, we will vectorize it, and it will become one column in this matrix. And this matrix, at the end of the day, will contain the data from all your subjects. And so, in other words, will be representative of the functional connectivity patterns of your whole population. At this stage, we need to set a hypothesis as to what we consider resting state to mean. We can consider that at each time point in the resting state acquisition, there is only one large-scale state of functional connectivity. And so we can try to disentangle this matrix into a subset of separate functional connectivity states, each of which occurs individually at each time point. And if you do this with additional, let's say, tricks to select the best frames in each subject, you get states such as those over here. Each of those states is expressed, only one of those states is expressed at each time point again. And so here, a red value in one of those states means that there is a particularly strong connectivity between the two areas that are concerned. If you want to compute informative metrics on this for your analysis, you can, for example, wonder how many times a given subject enters in each of those states. This would be a count measure. Or if a subject enters that state, how long the subject would stay in this state. This would be the dwell time. Otherwise, you can try to have another view on resting state data and to say that for you, at a given time point, there is not only one, but rather many separate networks that are active together, and that it's the combination of those networks that gives rise to the signal that you are recording. And so you can assume a linear combination of states at each time point, such as in the work from Leonardi and colleagues to retrieve so-called eigenconnectivity building blocks. So each of those building blocks, all of those building blocks are combined, are linearly combined at each time point to build the observed measurement. And so in this case, we actually are interested specifically in the dynamic fluctuations of activity. And so if you look at the bottom left of the slide, for each subject data, we demean, we remove mean connectivity, stationary connectivity, so that we are only sensitive to the dynamic fluctuations along this mean. And so for this reason, if you have a very red element here, it denotes a very strong change from mean connectivity. So the interpretation is different. In terms of metrics as well, because all the building blocks combine together at each time point, you can this time compute weights. You can compute how strongly a given building block is expressed at a given time point. Or you can look at a given time point at the particular set of building blocks and at their activity levels as one pattern. And this is referred to as a metastate. So we have now covered the traditional standing window pipeline. And I want to go into, for the next part, more innovative directions that you can try to apply to perform dynamic connectivity analysis. So a first possibility, instead of computing connectivity and to go for all that I explained, is to stay at the frame-wise level of analysis. And so to enter into more details, let's consider this graph here, where we depict the time course of a seed region from the brain. Instead of computing, as classically done, correlation between this seed time course and other voxels from the brain, you can instead threshold the signal and only retain a subset of frames for which the seed is more active than the threshold. And if you average those frames together for many separate seeds, you do find the same resting state networks as the ones from more traditional approaches. But the nice thing is that to do so, you just need the frames that survive the thresholding. And this can be less than 10% of the whole data. So it's computationally much more efficient. Of course, then, you, however, have to select a threshold to do so. You can then go even further with what is termed coactivation pattern analysis. So if we consider the evolution of a PCC, posterior cingulate cortex time course, which is the green time course over here, and the temporal activity of another hub from the default mode network, the medial prefrontal cortex in black, you observe that there are moments when the seed is active at the same time as the MPFC, for example, frame 2 here. But you also notice moments when the PCC is very active while the MPFC is not active. So it means that at different time points, actually, there are different sets of regions that are coactivating with the seed. So what we can do here is to take all the frames that survive the seed threshold delay and to separate them into several different patterns, so-called coactivation patterns. And if you do so in this particular example, this reflects the average of all the frames if you don't separate them into different clusters. And this reflects example clusters that you get if you try to separate them. What you see, for example, here is that coactivation pattern 1, which is present for 20% of the frames that retain thresholding, exhibits a very strong prefrontal signal with the PCC activation. But coactivation pattern 3, for example, has a much lower medial prefrontal signal. And coactivation pattern 2, for instance, is the only one that expresses hippocampal signal. So this is in itself an elaborate analytical tool, but this and all the other approaches that I've introduced so far still suffer from a major shortcoming. And this shortcoming is actually the hemodynamic effect, because you know that fMRI signals indirectly measure brain activity. They capture metabolic coupling. And so, or if you could actually retrieve a cleaned fMRI signal without added noise sources, it would not be truly directly reflective of the electrical activity from the brain. And so this is why you would ideally want to know a hemodynamic response function, what translates a spike of electrical activity into the metabolic response that you record. And you would like to go back from what I call the activity-related signal to the activity-inducing signal, the electrical signal. And of course, this is not as easy. And this is why frameworks trying to perform this have to add in other hypotheses in the optimization problem, such as in paradigm free mapping, where we assume that this activity inducing signal at each voxel is sparse. So this means the hypothesis here is that for each voxel, there will only be a restricted set of time points when that voxel will be active. Does this work? It does. if you consider those two subjects, where the first row and the second row, the middle row, index EMG recordings, subjects were instructed to perform finger tapping at some time points. And so this is when you see the EMG spikes on the top and on the middle row. And in the bottom row, you have the so-called activation time series signal. This is just the sum of voxels at a given time point that were active, that were kept as active by the framework. And you observe that you actually retrieve very large peaks in a purely data-driven fashion at the moments when the subjects were indeed moving their fingers. And if you try to look where in the brain those voxels that were active were located, you can confirm on the top here that they involved motor regions, as expected, and that the results fit pretty well with the ones from more standard methodologies. So finally, there is a way to go even in more advanced with this same analytical pipeline here, where again the activity-inducing signal reflects the neuronal excitability signal time course for a given voxel. So I can argue that in this signal, in order to find the moments with relevant information, it's enough to consider its derivative. Because if you have a positive peak in the derivative, it tells you when the voxel increased its activity level. And if you have a negative peak, it tells you when the voxel decreased its activity level. And so in the so-called total activation framework, we perform again a deconvolution, but this time we cast sparsity on the innovation signal, on this derivative signal. And as a second constraint plugged in the problem, we also demand that neighboring voxels in the brain exhibit similar time courses. And so here you have a realistic example on a real data set where the green time course reflects a voxel from the posterior cingulate cortex. And underlying it in black, you have the activity-related signal retrieved by total activation. Here you have the activity-inducing signal, which indeed exhibits kind of an on-off behavior. And here you have the innovation signal, the derivative of the middle row, which you see contains indeed positive peaks when that particular voxel was increasing its activity levels, and negative peaks when it was decreasing its activity levels. What you can do then is, for each voxel time course, to select the moments when those peaks are sufficiently strong, when those peaks are significant. And then, in a second stage, for each time point, to check whether there is a significant number of voxels that show an innovation together. In this case, it would mean maybe that the whole brain network containing many different voxels changed its activity pattern. If you do this, and if you cluster only those frames, you can actually retrieve the so-called innovation-driven coactivation patterns, which, as you can see, accurately reflect many well-known resting state networks. And the particularly nice thing about this methodology is that you can have both temporal and spatial overlap of those ICAPs. So the activity time courses of those networks can overlap, and the spatial patterns can overlap as well, which is not necessarily something that can be achieved with more standard methodologies. So for example, here, we have a full default mode network, ICAP. You see there is frontal signal. Here we have another retrieved ICAP with no frontal signal. So this is a posterior DMM. So finally, there is another possible innovative avenue for future research, which would be to cascade temporal modeling on the activity or the connectivity works that I've described so far. And let me now try to explain this a little bit better, focusing on the work by Majid and colleagues from a few years ago, where the authors attempted to retrieve, in a resting state scanning session, a spatial temporal sequence of activity. So what they did is that they first randomly picked a subset of frames from a full fMRI time series, and they tried to correlate this template with the whole time series. And so they generated a correlation, sliding correlation time course. Then they looked at the peaks, the moments when that template was overlapping pretty well with the actual sequence of volumes. They took those subsets of frames and they averaged them together into an updated template. They performed this intuitively until convergence, and they found a template that is indeed strongly expressed many, many times as depicted here during a full resting state scanning session. And when you look over the course of 20 seconds from the top to the bottom of the slide, you can see in this template that the DMM switches from a state of deactivation in blue here to a state of activation in red. And so I think this report calls for a major organizing principle of the brain, because it means that if you are in a particular configuration at a particular time point, you will not evolve randomly to another. You will be strongly constrained by that configuration to move in a particular spatial-temporal sequence of activity. And so the goal is to try to capture this evolution. And several people have suggested hypotheses and ways to do this. The first possibility could be to hypothesize that those changes over time have to be slow in the way they happen. And so you could try to smoothen up the activity or the connectivity estimates that you gather. For example, with a sliding window analysis pipeline, you could say that two connectivity estimates from neighboring windows, you can constrain that they have to be very similar to each other. This is an interesting approach, but I told you in the dynamic graph analysis part that there are very often abrupt whole brain changes in interactions between brain regions. So probably this hypothesis is actually not so well fitting. Another possibility that was used by Smith and colleagues to disentangle resting state networks is to assume that they will evolve independently from each other over time in activity. And although it was possible with this approach to retrieve interpretable resting state maps, it doesn't really make physiological sense to guess that all those different functional networks are independent. For example, I showed you at the start of the presentation that the default mode network and the task positive network are intercorrelated, so they have a very strong relationship to each other. And so maybe you will want to use a more general, more flexible tools that could really render any possible dynamics from the data. And so to perform temporal modeling per se. So the advantage is the flexibility and the fact that when you have obtained models to characterize the dynamics of your system, you can also generate new data at will. So this is a generative type of approaches. However, you need a very big amount of data to do so. And of course, you need to cleverly think about what the best hypotheses regarding your resting state paradigm are. So for example, here we have the suggestion by Iavani and colleagues, where the x time points reflect the observed time courses that we acquire. So the authors hypothesized with a temporal modeling approach that at each time point, there would be only one large-scale functional connectivity state. And so they used this to retrieve model parameters for all states in the form of covariance matrices and transition probability values, and to also retrieve the most likely sequence of states. What is the sequence between those three states that I depict here that can most likely explain the observed measurements? So finally, hopefully all that I've been telling you about so far is really relevant and really concerns neuronal fluctuations. We hope that it doesn't only include noise or spurious artifacts, right? It would be pretty disappointing. And so, of course, you need to check for this. And there have also been a lot of attempts at thoroughly analyzing the statistical validity of dynamic fluctuations. So here I just want to outline one possible strategy amongst many others to do so. This is computed from phase-scrambled null data. And you can observe that for different values of stationary functional connectivity, the dispersion in the dynamic range of values is not the same. And so what the authors did for each connectivity pair that they acquired with a sliding window pipeline was to pick the appropriate stationary functional connectivity and the appropriate null distribution that went with it. And so they used this null distribution highlighted with the colors here for thresholding of the time course. And so they did this for all their time courses here to select for each time course only the temporal subset of data points when you will have significant positive or negative excursions. So after having validated that you indeed record neuronally related changes, does it really match electrical activity from the brain? Again, yes, it does. Because if you try to correlate connectivity time courses with electrical brain measurements, for example, power measurements acquired with electroencephalography, you also find very strong correlations that spread throughout many brain regions. And finally, we of course want dynamic connectivity to make sense regarding cognition and regarding demographics, for instance. And so a few years ago, Hutchison and colleagues showed with a state separation approach that a subset of the states that they could extract from resting state recordings would exhibit a different degree of expression, both in terms of counts and in mean dwell time with increasing age in the population of subjects. So there is a link between some dynamic functional connectivity features and some demographic variables. Is it the same with arousal? It is. I already told you about the caffeine study that I mentioned before in the presentation, And there is also, for example, a relationship with anesthesia. As an example, Amico and colleagues applied a coactivation pattern analysis with the posterior cingulate cortex as a seed. And they showed that in the second coactivation pattern, which is the most striking result from the study, you find medial prefrontal cortex activation in wakefulness time points, but you don't have any medial prefrontal cortex anymore when you are unconscious. So again, dynamic connectivity can capture changes in arousal levels. And finally, it also correlates with cognition. I've already showed you the reports from Hussey with daydreaming, or from Chen and colleagues about cognitive flexibility. And here is one last example from the group of Sadagyan, which I really like because it's not inter-individual, but rather an intra-individual assessment. So the way this worked is that they had blindfolded subjects that had to try and locate when an auditory stimulus would come. And so sometimes they would accurately pinpoint the stimulus. This is what they called the hits. And sometimes they would fail at pinpointing the stimulus. This is what they called the misses. They then computed functional connectivity in small windows just before the hits and the misses, and they showed, with two different parcellations of the brain, that there were a lot of significant differences. And then they tried to go further, and they performed graph analysis. It turned out that before the hits, modularity in the graph is much larger than before the misses. And actually, this is the stationarily computed modularity, which is also higher. It makes sense because I told you that most of the time the brain is constrained by structure and you are in this state when you have separate modules that don't interact. And so it is in this type of states that you are very receptive to those stimuli. And you are less receptive to those stimuli when those modules are actually interacting together and exchanging information. Finally, to conclude, it's of course essential to mention the fact that dynamic connectivity also relates to several brain disorders and is altered in those settings. So for example, with schizophrenia, the group of Calhoun computed connectivity states for healthy controls on the top and for schizophrenia individuals in the bottom. And they first tried to look at the spatial differences between those maps. And for state 2 and state 3, they saw insightful differences that involved subcortico-cortical connections. They are the red and the blue stripes that I hope you can see in the figures over here. And so if you go there, they actually reflect those time points here. You can see that for the thalamic regions, in green, functional connectivity was larger in the schizophrenia individuals, whereas for putamen to cortical connectivity, it was larger in healthy controls. And then they went to the other side and computed temporal metrics. They looked at how long a given subject would stay in a given state. And they saw here that control subjects would tend to spend a longer time in states 1 and 2, whereas schizophrenia subjects would tend to spend a longer time in state 4 and in state 5. So as a general summary, to recap all of this, we first went through the traditional Slanning-Winnow analytical pipeline, and I told you that you can try to methodologically enhance it at several points, either at the point of the rectangular windows that you're using, or at the point of the connectivity estimate. And then we saw that there are also ways to extract more relevant and more intuitive summarizing information from a dynamic functional connector in the form of dynamic graph analysis or of the extraction of DFC states. Afterwards, we saw that you can also go for a first-level frame-wise approach instead of computing connectivity, and that you can also get insightful maps of coactivation by this mean. And finally, we saw that it's also possible to cascade temporal modeling attempts on those activity or connectivity measurements to really get a firmer grasp at the dynamics of your system. And so now I want to briefly conclude with a few words on the hands-on tutorial that is to follow, because you will now try to apply yourself some of the topics that I've been discussing. So there must be USB keys that should be traveling around in the room. So I would ask all the attendants, if possible, to get a grasp at one of the three keys that are somewhere in the audience, and to try and get the BrainHack folder from the USB key on your computers. Because this is the folder that contains the data, the instructions, all the relevant information to perform the tutorial. So for the ones who haven't had this USB key yet, please try to look for your neighbors and find one. Normally there should be three separate keys. And there's one over there, for example. So maybe the ones that haven't had the data yet on their computers could raise their hand. And the ones who have a key could maybe try to to give it? I think, Frank, you don't have it yet?
I'm using it.
All right. No, it doesn't. So, in the first exercise, you will be dealing with standing window analysis. So, you will be applying a full standing window pipeline yourself. You will be able to play with window length, window step, window shape. You will compute graph metrics, the cross-spring coefficient, and the degree dynamically. And you will also extract eigen connectivities. So, we provide you with a MATLAB script that does this. And you have an instruction PDF document also in the folder that explains step by step how things are done with explanations on the MATLAB code, and which also contains questions that you are asked to solve. So there are a lot of questions, and I don't think that you will be able to finish the whole tutorial today. So don't panic and don't try to rush. I think it's better if you just select what interests you most or start, and then if you finish later on somewhere else when you have more time, if you're interested. We also provide solutions in the folder, so you can look at the solutions by yourself afterwards. And if you have any question, you can always mail us, contact us, ask us for anything. So for this tutorial, I think the best is that you will try to work from your computer. If you have questions, you just raise your hand and we'll come and we'll try to help you with anything. So I can help with both parts. Eunice is the specialist of the second exercise. Which actually involves total activation and innovation-driven co-activation patterns. So you will be given outputs from total activation, and you will have to write some code to generate ICAPs. If you want to do so, we also provide you the already implemented code if you prefer to directly apply it. And Anjali is responsible for the standing window analysis part, so she can answer questions for this half of the tutorial. So yeah, I think I let you start, and if you have any question or any problem, just raise your hand and one of us will come at you. Thanks a lot.